Very much. First, let me start by thanking those who have spoken before me. There is a sense in which they have covered quite a number of things in Togo, or talked about critical issues, as did my good friend Dr. Folefak and John Poco. And I think that the issues have been distilled in a very effective way. We then allow me to simply try and suggest some of the things that can be done. And as you know, this is essentially a moving target, so that the prescription that we offer are not cast in stone. But it's important to remind ourselves why it is that the African Union did in the year 2013 arrive at the realization that you needed to silence the guns. This was on the occasion of the 50th anniversary of the Organization of African Unity. And I think there was unanimity that African development had been undermined by the conflicts. Just as an example, and the statistics give and take, the intra-African trade stands at less than 20%. There are conflicting figures, but about anything between 16 and 18%. Compare with the trade in Asia, which stands at anything between 52 and 55%. Compare that with Europe, which I think stands at about 70%. And compare that with the Americas, which is slightly shy of 60%. And it gives and lends credence to what our good friend Adisa said from Barbados. And I think that Dr. Folefak also spoke to it. The problem of a person in Ambazonia is so remote to a person as close to Ambazonia as Nigeria. And all these therefore tells you that the realization of the African unity was informed by that. And the decision then taken was that by the year 2020, which is the year in which we are, conflicts will be eliminated as a prerequisite to allowing peace and development. And that must then be seen in the context of realizing the promises that we made to ourselves under Africa Agenda 2063. And let us isolate, even as we begin to talk about elimination of conflicts. And I think it's Dr. Folefak who talked about the resource conflicts. Some of the conflicts, and he mentioned Boko Haram, which we are familiar with. And you know that this has been cast as a religious conflict. There are those who argue that the religion is the excuse rather than the reason, the alibi rather than the reason. And sometimes you hear about the conflict between the farmers and the pastoralists. You remember this thing was being thought about by the President Buhari's regime. So there are those conflicts, particularly in the Sahelian region. And those conflicts are also to be found, if you count the East African region, amongst the Turkana, amongst the Karamojong, because many of these fellows in their activities do not recognize these artificial boundaries. So in the year 2013, the African Union asked, and where are these guns? Where are these guns that we want to silence? And the guns were seen to be present in the Sahelian region, preponderantly Mali, Mauritania, Burkina Faso, and of course in Ambazonia, and when you came to Central African Republic, the Democratic Republic of Congo, and Burundi. And if you came to Sudan, and even right now, when we thought that we had resolved the Sudan, South Sudan problem, and somebody talked about a BA, which remains unresolved today. And of course, you now know that there is the SPLM North, the people from the Nuba Mountain, the Darfur region. And then you come to the East African region, you have the Somali problem. And right now, there is also an insurgency in Mozambique. You can see, therefore, that the conflicts have been spreading. And in order to make a prescription, I think Dr. Folifak will agree with me that diagnosis is critical. Otherwise, you prescribe a solution that does not make sense. If, for example, you are talking about resource, and let me give you a possible source of conflict as we speak now, the spat between Sudan, Ethiopia, and Egypt regarding the Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam. This is something that has a history from the colonial times, when the Egyptians controlled Egypt up to East Africa. There were two treaties, the 1929 Nile Treaty and the 1949 Nile Treaty. And it allowed the Egyptians to believe that all the waters of the Nile, whether it's the blue or the white Nile, was meant for them. How do you resolve those conflicts? There are those are resource conflicts which are emerging. Then there are also boundary conflicts which are also resource related. Right now, you know, for example, that we have the conflict between Kenya and Somalia on the maritime boundary. In West Africa, I think we had the Bakassi Peninsula, which was resolved. And we also have territorial, apart from the resource ones, we also have territorial and settled territorial disputes. And you see that on the Lake Malawi, the conflict between Malawi and Tanzania on the lake. And you find that even on Lake Tanganyika. And if you go outside of that in certain areas, you'll find internal conflicts, the Caprivi Strip in Namibia. So how do you deal with those? I'm just isolating the nature of the conflicts so that when we begin to talk about these prescriptions, we are clear that they are resource, they are clear that some of them are inherited boundaries, and some are simply ethnic conflicts. If you look at some of the historical conflicts which are ethnically based that led to early attempts at secession, the Democratic Republic of Congo, you remember the Katanga problem. You'll also remember the ongoing problem, the Biafra problem, which brought about the civil war in Nigeria in the 1960s. But this must be understood in the context of the decision that were made in 1963. In 1963, there were possibilities of redrawing the colonially inherited boundaries. But the OAU took the view that any attempt at redrawing the boundaries would create conflict. Therefore, they came about with what was described as the doctrine of the inviolability of the boundaries. And it was assumed at that time that if you make them inviolable, then you reduce rather than eliminate conflict. Whether it was a good decision or not, I do not know, but at least the boundaries remain generally stable. And I think it is only two instances that we have seen those boundaries being disturbed by way of peace negotiation. The creation of South Sudan out of the Sudan, and then, of course, the emergence of Eritrea out of Ethiopia. We see there have been attempts, for example, and Dr. Folefa gave us a very useful historical context of how the Cameroons were mined together. You can also see this was very deliberate by the colonialists. Nigeria mined together, Sudan mined together, the Lara Republic also mined together, and all these were issues which then created a very fertile ground for conflict. And then, of course, all of us know that these boundaries were fairly arbitrary. So if you go to Ghana, for example, Ghana and Togo, You find that one ethnic group finds itself in Ghana and they are also in Togo. And this is common in quite a number of countries. You come to Uganda and Kenya and Tanzania. So this kind of thing, you go to Darfur and Central African Republic and that kind of thing. So the conflicts present themselves in a very unique way. Is Hydra-headed. And of course, there is also the religion. You know, this conflict of religion, and I stand to be corrected by you, ladies and gentlemen. Religion has now become something that we say they are Muslims, so that in Nigeria, there is this idea that they remember the Abuja Declaration, the unrolling of the carpet, that the Muslims made a vow that they are going to Islamize the entire continent of Africa by rolling the carpet. But there is merit in that. There are those fringe elements who use religion. As to whether they are dyed in the wool votaries of those religions is a totally different case. But we have seen this ugly head of this conflict rearing its head in Central African Republic, with the Seleka and Banta Seleka in Central African Republic. We have seen that happening in Nigeria, where religion has also been a factor. We have seen that as we speak now, there is an insurgency that is going on in, as I said, in northern Mozambique. And I think the SADC forces have taken the stand that they are going to intervene. And then you go to other very interesting situations. And somebody talked about it. That is ethnic nationalism. If you go to Ethiopia, for example, after the post-Haile Selassie and post-Mengistu Haile Mariam, when Meles Zenawi came in with his administration after the successful guerrilla warfare, the 1984 Ethiopian constitution actually allows for secession based on ethnic nationalism. So that the country is divided into federal units, but is open for the Oromo upon satisfying certain things to secede. It's possible for the Tigrinya to do the same. It's possible for the Amhara to do the same. So there are also those issues. And then there are those issues of governance. And I always remember these words of John Garang de Mabior in Sudan, when he was agitating not for the secession of South Sudan. He said, we wanted a united Sudan. But it cannot happen when the Muslims, at least Al-Turabi, the scholars of the Muslim at that time, think that Africans must be Islamized and Arabized. And he said, make Sudan attractive. Make it attractive so that you create structures that will take care of the minority, and then we remain in a country that is respectful of the minority. And I think once again it's Dr. Folefak who gave the example of the thing that is called the United Kingdom, which is not very united, but they are a very interesting group of people. When it is convenient, they are the United Kingdom and Great Britain. When it is inconvenient, they are Wales, they are Scots, and they are Irish, and they are English. So all those conflicts then make us ask the question, how do we resolve these conflicts? The one area of conflict with which is the last one I mentioned, then I go to my prescription so that I allow for some debate, is in the area of governance. When most countries embraced multi-party democracy, particularly after the collapse of the Berlin Wall in 1989, elections became very conflictual. In many African countries, you had these elections, and after every election, there was conflict. In Kenya, there was conflict. In Zambia, there was a low-key conflict. In Uganda, in Burundi, in Rwanda, in the Democratic Republic of Congo, in Togo, in Guinea-Bissau, in the Cameroon, in Gambia. One can go on and on. After every election cycle, there is conflict. So the African Union in the month of January the 30th, to be exact, came up with the African Charter on democracy and election governance. And the idea was that there was a litmus test. An election must satisfy the litmus test in order for it to be accepted as a way of accepting that the people have spoken. And it is in that context, for example, that they said taking power by means other than constitutional means will not be condoned. In fact, the goodwill delegation that was in Bamako, Mali, to address the removal of Keita is informed by that we do not allow coup d'etats. But what is interesting is that when there was fundamentally a coup d'etat against Robert Mugabe, the voices were not as explicit as they are in the case of Keita. Which then brings me to what I want to conclude with. How then do we begin to resolve this conflict? I think number one, it is important to deal with some of the causes. I've seen some people talking about food and hunger, to deal with very basic things. And Dr. Fonefak once again talked about Abraham Maslow's pyramid of human wants. Some of these conflicts are essential because people have no food. And if they have no food, they don't recognize boundaries. And if they don't recognize boundaries, then they cause conflict. So we must begin to address these issues, very basic issues like the ability to feed our people, address agriculture, address health, address education, provide potable water for people, enhance trade, remove these artificial boundaries. Those of you who are in Europe know that you can move without let and hindrance from Lisbon in Portugal to Bratislava in Slovakia. But here in Africa, we have 34 passports and 34 currencies. So you find that there are points of conflict which can be eliminated if we brought down the boundaries, as indeed I hope the Africa Continental Free Trade Area will, as I believe the opening of the skies under the Yamoussoukro Protocol, I hope will, and by the introduction of a single passport will, so that these issues of xenophobia, our good friend from Barbados, Addis Andwele, talked about their affinity to the people of Sierra Leone, because a lot of Temnes and Menes were actually the ones who were spirited to what is sometimes referred to as the West Indies or the Caribbean. So I think addressing those basic things is also going to be very important. Number two, to look at governance generally, I think this democracy as given to us by the conceptual West also needs re-examination. I do not have an answer, but I think it needs re-examination. Number three, let us address the extant problems of persons who are marginalized. And this is where you begin to talk about, take for example in the Cameroons, what is the attraction of the Yaounde government to the person in Boya, in Amazonia? What is the attraction? Why should it be there? Why should you remain in a country or in a construct that doesn't take care of you? And I think that these are critical issues that must be addressed by looking at the governance system. And then we must also remember that apart from the domestic problems, there are, and as somebody said, I agree with him, the tide of the continent will ensure that we have these conflicts. And that is why I think at the regional level, we must also cooperate. We saw when there was problem in Liberia, ECOMOC intervened quite effectively. We saw when there was conflict in East Africa, the East African community intervened very effectively in South Sudan, and also is still intervening in Somalia. I think that regional bodies are also very important. We saw recently in the case of Yahya Jammeh in the Gambia, when he did not want to leave power, the ECOWAS came very firmly. I think that those regional interventions are also very useful. I think that SADC should also intervene very firmly in the case of Mozambique. So stand by regional forces are going to be very important in terms of ensuring that we deal with these conflicts. And Poco also said that there is no shortage of initiative. We have now created different ways of intervening. And people don't know. Perhaps if these interventions were not there, there would be many more conflicts. And I, all these factors conjoined, because I must conclude, are critical in resolving these disputes. Remember that conflict is a permanent nature and feature of human affairs. Right now, we are fond of talking about Europe. But as we speak now, there is a problem in Belarus, in Europe. As we speak now, there are problems in Eastern Ukraine, in Europe. As we speak now, there are problems in Chechnya. And you find that there are also problems in Asia. So it is how you mediate and midwife these conflicts that will make you able to appreciate and resolve them. And the last thing that I want to say is, going forward, the African Union must be very strong, initially through the regional bodies. Remember that the month of September, which is only 1 week away, is the week of amnesty for anybody who bears arms. I haven't heard the African Union come out loudly to say, all arms, anybody who bears arms, these are the established areas where those arms will be surrendered. I would want to hear that, because September is only a week away. I would want to see what you are going to, if you are talking about Boko Haram, you are talking about Al-Shabaab, where are they going to surrender these arms? What is the infrastructure? What is the structure that is in place? And once they have surrendered them, what is the rehabilitation process? Because these are people who have been used to bearing arms, sometimes as a way of livelihood. So they give you the gun, then how do they survive? So these are things that I would want to see on the table, but because I don't want to hog the conversation, I think, as I conclude, that there are many prescriptions, but the critical thing.
We appear to have lost Professor Lumumba. I'll give it a few seconds to see if he comes back.
Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you so much for that, Professor. As always, very, very intriguing and interesting remarks. I actually will not even add or subtract to anything that you have said. We appreciate those words. Ladies and gentlemen, we're now just going to